Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Apologies for slightly inadequate seating. If anyone wants to sit down here in the front, there is actually some room down here if you don't mind sitting on the floor, or you're welcome to stand at the back. But apologies that we didn't put out enough chairs. We were forbidden from doing so, apparently. Welcome, and thank you very much for coming out to this meeting. We are focusing this evening on the refugee crisis, but from a Syrian perspective, and we have a panel of four Syrians. The word refugee, of course, has technical and legal aspects attached to it, and not everyone here is technically a refugee, but in reality, they all are, in the sense that Syria is no longer really inhabitable in many ways for the majority of people. And hence, you've seen one of the largest flows of refugees out of a country since World War II. The panel is all men, as I'm sure some of you have noticed. Unfortunately, we did try very hard to find a woman who would come and speak, and we were not able to do so. And in part, that reflects, I think, a problem in the university, which is that we have for several years been trying to raise money to bring in more students and faculty from Syria to provide a refuge for a country that's been torn apart by one of the most devastating wars of recent years. We haven't been able to raise that money. And it shows, really, that sadly, there's been not necessarily an institutional indifference here, but among the people who provide funding, there has been an institutional indifference to the plight of Syrians, to the plight of Syrian intellectuals who are caught between a regime and ISIS and other groups, all of whom are opposed to free intellectual life in various ways. Anyway, I'm not going to talk any longer than this. I just want to briefly introduce my two colleagues here. Ahakam Shah and Aminak Tokmayan, who both work with me in the Center for Conflict Negotiation and Recovery, and one of our students at SPP, Yayal Abdullah, who's just joined us on the MPA program, and Man Abu Leila, who is a refugee here in Hungary. They're going to talk, Hakam first. Man is going to speak in Arabic, and Hakam will translate his speech. Anyway, we're going to go through some fairly rapid presentations and then open it up for questions. Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you, everybody, for coming. It's a very big topic, so obviously, as much as we want to cover, we can't. I will try, though, to give a brief idea about the situation for Syrians, both in Syria and in Turkey, and then just make a commentary about what I believe and what many other Syrians believe is the needed solution. Just this afternoon, and before I start with what I had prepared to talk about, a group of from the Berlin Social Science Center and a group of Syrians did a survey of 900 Syrian refugees in German camps. They are from all provinces, and they asked them about questions related to Syria, why they fled, for example, when they came to Germany, and whether they believed they would come back. Also, what they believe would stop this flow from Syria into Germany. So let's start with what's fresh today, and it's published in Der Spiegel, so you could find it if you want for more details. 65% of them left in 2015. So did they come from the camps in Jordan and Turkey? This doesn't say that. It says that rather they are newcomers directly from Syria. Most of them are. 89% had their homes shelled. 73% believed that barrel bombs were a threat to their own personal safety. They said that, not believed. And who was responsible for the shelling in their area? The majority say it's the Syrian army and its allied groups. Of course, participants could answer with more than one answer. So it could be both, I believe, both regime and ISIS, or regime and the Free Syrian Army. What do they believe people would make people stay in Syria if, what would make people stay in Syria? More humanitarian aid, just one quarter of them. A no-fly zone, 58%. Does that mean bombing of Syrian military bases? Not necessarily, just stop the bombing. Of course, there's also the weapon deliveries that they see as a threat. What would actually make them go back? The war has to stop. That's the main reason. Assad has to go. Free elections. Daesh with 43.8. Daesh is ISIL, ISIS. Has to go. Now this is probably, this gives a big idea about things already, what I have mentioned. Now I'll go in more detail. This is the map of Syria. This is the what you see, the areas of control. ISIS controls a big part of Syria, but this is mostly sparsely populated. So doesn't mean they have power over the majority of Syrians. They don't. What you see is the southeast is the Syrian desert. It's called the Syrian desert. In the north, these are fertile lands that there are no big cities, but like towns and villages based on agriculture. Green, the rebels, the opposition, including, if you see white, this is al-Nusra Front. They are mainly Syrian fighters, and they have a relatively okay reputation among many, but not all, not with me at least, because I don't approve of many of their practices. However, they work for the people in Syria. They are affiliated with Al-Qaeda. They're not necessarily Al-Qaeda. And there is a thought that they might one day remove their connection with Al-Qaeda, but we don't know about that. As we see, still they're not the biggest group, but they're becoming bigger and bigger. Red is regime, and the yellow or orange is the Kurds. So why all that happened in Syria? The majority probably know, but just a recap. Syria has been ruled by the same party, which is called the Ba'ath Arabist Socialist Party, since 1963. That's more than 50 years. Even worse, it's not only a party issue. It's actually a minority elite. The power elite is from the minorities, the Alawite minority mainly, that gradually took over power by expelling, for example, Sunni officers from the army. So that's army-wise. Civilian life-wise, that came later, probably one, two decades later, when people started to feel that they have little say in many things. They are marginalized because they don't come from the power elite at the top. It's like the pyramid. The better you are connected to the top of the pyramid, the better your chances in having a good life and a dignified life are. Hafez Assad took part of the coup d'etat in 1963, and then he became the president in 1970. His brother Rifat al-Assad, now in Europe, almost controlled Syria in 1983 in a kind of unsuccessful coup d'etat, and then he fled. Basil al-Assad, Hafez Assad's son, so Hafez ruled 30 years, then he was being prepared for power. 1994, he was killed. Nobody knows the reason. They say it's a car crash. Bashar al-Assad was next. He's an MD, but he's not an ophthalmologist because he did not finish his studies. He just went there for 2 years, and he was asked to come back to Syria to be prepared for power. Very quickly, he was promoted. Next to him, on the left, is Maher al-Assad, his brother, who now is the head of the 4th Division in the Syrian Army, which are the elite forces. Asif Shaukat, the late brother-in-law of Bashar al-Assad, he was the head of the one of the main intelligence services in Syria. Atif Najib, he is the cousin of Bashar al-Assad, and he was the head of the military intelligence in Deraa when things started there, the uprising in 2011. He was responsible mainly for torturing children who sprayed who sprayed with the graffiti on the walls down with the regime. The people want the toppling of the regime, which is something they saw on TV, like Al Jazeera, happening in Tunisia or Egypt. Of course, he was not fired or sacked or anything. He was moved to a different province. So this is just an example. When you talk about the actual power, it's all in the hands of the army and the security intelligences. Even when it comes to business, you either have to do business deals with the security services or with this guy, Rami Makhlouf. He is Bashar's cousin, and he owns a zillion businesses in Syria, from real estate companies to restaurants and hotels to the two communications operators. There was a monopoly of that. That's a lot of money. And of course, the fees were very high in Syria. Like, we always felt bad that everything is cheaper in Syria compared to other countries except telecommunications, mobile phones. Yeah. Understandably, there was an uprising. Gradually, for 6 months it was peaceful. People took to the streets gradually, and there was a point where in Hama, some say over 100,000 people protested. The governor of Hama had a deal with the protesters that, okay, we don't want violence, we let you this time, blah, blah, blah. While in other provinces, there was very heavy crackdown. Almost every week, about 100 protesters were shot dead. And you can find thousands, literally thousands of YouTube videos that show that. What happened to this governor? He was sacked because he allowed this to happen. Also, what the regime did is they said, look, guys, this is a sectarian, it's a sectarian conspiracy, it's a cosmic conspiracy, sectarianism, all that. It's because it's Sunni that are underrepresented in the whole country who are leading this, so it's a sectarian thing. So you don't want Alawites, so you hate Alawites, you are sectarian. And what they did is something similar to what the Orban government did here. They had billboards with that say, no to sectarian strife, yes for tolerance and common living. And it shows you the mosque minaret and the church cross. Of course, there was a sectarian problem in Syria. Of course there was. And it mainly was not between Muslims and Christians, but it was the result of sectarianism by the regime that favored Alawites and made them victims to this power control method. I definitely don't believe Alawites are, of course, needless to say, there's a historical reason for them to want to stay in power forever. It's just they were manipulated by the regime. And there was a problem, of course. Meanwhile, protesters, and this is from Aleppo, from the Bustan al-Qasr district, civil society activity was growing. there was mobilization among Syrians. They started to feel they matter, they can do things. And one of the slogans that are repeated in every protest is, one, 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 the Syrian people are one. And then again in green you see one in Arabic, then one in Hindi numerals, and one in Arabic numerals. And then it says, understand it for God's sake. I was in one of these protests, and this is what we always said. Of course, gradually, things started when sectarianism grew bigger, and when people, especially the underprivileged Sunnis, started to see that they are faced with sectarianism from the regime, they started to highlight their Sunni, the Sunni aspect of the revolution. And in one of the protests that I was in, and I was very much upset, in 2012, people said, our leader forever is Prophet Muhammad. This is a counter slogan for the supporters, pro-regimers, protesters who say, our leader forever is Bashar al-Assad, and before that was Hafez al-Assad. So now it's Prophet Muhammad. It's not a uniting figure, but it's a Muslim figure. Just again, of the example of the crackdown, this happened, and sectarianism, of course, this happened in Baida, in a kind of majority Alawite province. This village, Sunni village in that province, was attacked. People had no weapons or anything, and the soldiers were filming that, how the soldiers were standing on people, beating them, and all that. And that's a not graphic photo at all. That I made sure I don't choose one that's like that. Now, what's the situation like in Syria now? There is a war. Gradually, this couldn't be sustained, so people made use of that in Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Turkey, and started to send weapons, tell people, you can fight, pick up the arms, how long can you be peaceful in the face of this violent crackdown? And we started to see foreigners from all nationalities flooding into Syria, including on the regime side, later on a bit. The Iranian generals, Qasem Soleimani, for example, one of the generals, leader of the Quds Brigade, he is based in Syria mainly, and Iraq sometimes, and he oversees the Syrian regime operations and oversees the organization of factions from mainly Shia from Afghanistan and from Iran and Hezbollah. If it was only a fight on the ground, that's a problem, but it's not the biggest problem. The biggest problem is the way the regime now fights, or since mid-2013, fights the opposition. Basically, bombing Sunni areas, or whichever area that's not under their control, and it has been only Sunni so far. Of course, Alawites are 10% in Syria, Sunnis are about 75 Sunni Arabs. Hundreds of barrel bombs sometimes a week, and the number of killings is just so high that I'm not going to focus on this today. Understandably, people leave. There are many other reasons as well. Now, including, for example, conscription for males to the army, which they don't want. Now, they leave Syria and they started to go to Turkey, Jordan, Lebanon. I'm not going to talk about Jordan and Lebanon, but I lived in Turkey for 3 years, and from what I saw, first it was so clear that the government wanted to have the attitude, which still holds, that we are brothers, you are not even refugees, we host you, and all that. 2 million people came to Turkey. About 400,000 are in refugee camps. However, the situation for them is not very much good. If you are not in the camp, you have to spend from your savings to rent a house. So understandably, your finances finish soon. If you want to work, you have to work in the black market, job market. Your pay is very little. It could be as little as about $200 a month for young men in the textile industry in Istanbul, for example, and they could only pay their expenses and their rent. And where do they live? They live in shared rooms even. So within the room, there are like six beds, and they have one bed there. They work 16 hours sometimes, or as long as they can work. Understandably, many would want a better future than this. Of course, no promise of any improvement in the future, not even becoming a citizen, because in order for you to become a Turkish citizen, you need to have a work residence permit for 5 years, which the majority don't have. Now, I don't want this to be understood as though most or a big percentage come from neighboring countries. Actually, they don't. As we have seen, 65% of refugees in Germany, for example, have been coming from Syria directly because they came in 2015. So it's they can't have started a life there and then changed their mind. Now, what I think needs to be done in Syria is moving from dealing with the symptoms to dealing with the root causes. And obviously, and as you have seen, Syrians see barrel bombs as the main cause, the airstrikes. Now there's a question, now Russia is involved, so how can we just, I mean, what if we shoot down Russian aircraft? Do we engage in a Cold War? Well, of course, it's the international community that's to blame for being this late about it. But what could still be done is maybe anti-aircraft missiles. There's, again, the threat of these falling into the hands of the wrong hands, Al-Qaeda, for example. So you have to give them in small amounts as a deterrent against aircraft that's bombing the people. Now, another important thing is to move from generalizations to understanding things, in engaging in Syria in responsibly and in more attention to details. We have to stop actually painting, like every battalion we talk about with the same brush. We have to realize that, okay, battalion X, faction X, group X, population X have these problems, but they also, we can rely on these pro points. But again, to emphasize and to stop, to give the floor to actually Yahya now, as long as we're just watching what's going on in Syria and we don't stop what's obviously the main reason, which is the bombing from the sky, this problem will continue to grow and the refugee crisis will continue to grow big. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody, and thank you very much for joining us in this evening. Thank you, Hakan, for the comprehensive overview. I know it's not an easy job to give an overview of a country which has been in a war for almost 5 years now. Actually, I'm not going to be long. I'm going to talk about a very specific aspect in the conflict. I'm going to try to give you an image about life in Syria under ISIS. So, sorry, can I have a mic? Okay, so the map will be, I don't have lots of slides, only one. So, first of all, I'd like to say, who is ISIS or who are the people who are fighting for ISIS? Well, ISIS, first of all, represents a very small group of Muslims, and they are called under the category of Salafis. But again, we should understand that Salafis are like a group with subcategories. So mainly the people who are joining ISIS are the jihadists, the takfiris, and the millennials. I want to concentrate on the last one, the millennials, and those are the ones who think it's like the end of the time, and it's their duty to do like something, because we are going to be doomed very soon. So that's why you see those guys are very, very violent and very, very aggressive. Now, a very interesting question is ISIS or are those guys Muslims? The answer is yes, they are, simply because they identify themselves so, and they follow like specific things in Islam. But more interestingly and more important, I think, is do they represent Islam, or do they represent Muslim people? And the answer is clearly no. They are not the representative of Islam, and they are not the representative of Muslim people. Okay, moving on to who is fighting for ISIS. Well, according to like a latest report from the Telegraph, there are around 20,000 foreign fighters fighting for ISIS or recruited by ISIS. And those 20,000 fighters come pretty much from all over the world. And there is a ranking hierarchy in the organization, or whatever they call themselves, like the state. And the leading figures in the organization are not Syrians at all. So basically they are ruled by ex-Iraqi officials, defected or were fighting in the war against America with Saddam Hussein. And lots of people who came from Pakistan, Afghanistan, Chechnya, and so on. So those are the ranking officials in ISIS. The rest, or after that, comes the foreign fighters or the Europeans, and finally comes the Syrians. So why did I say they do not represent Islam at all? Simply because if we look at the target, their target, or the victims so far, we can see that basically they are not fighting against the main cause they came for, which is Assad. Number one in their target is the Syrian rebels, or what we call the Free Syrian Army. Since the very beginning, ISIS did not go and attack the Syrian army at all. They did not even come close. They started with the liberated areas, or the areas which were under the control of the Free Syrian Army, because their mission was very clear, that first of all, we need to build a very strong Islamic structure, then we can go and fight Assad. So they started attacking and killing members of the Free Syrian Army and civilians. And at some point at the beginning, it was there was a say among all the Syrians that ISIS is the creation of the Syrian regime, simply because they are killing the enemy of the Syrian regime. And they were like gaining power there without even having any like direct clash with the Syrian regime. Of course, the scenario changed a little bit afterwards, but still till now, ISIS's main target is the Free Syrian Army and the other militias among the rebels. One incident that happened last year is the massacre they did to one of the tribes in eastern Syria, and the tribe is called Shaitat. And this tribe was trying to have a deal or be affiliated with Al-Nusra Front, and they literally like killed almost everybody in this tribe. And this tribe is Muslim Sunni. They are not Shiite, they are not Alawite, they are not Christians. They are just Muslim Sunni, so that's again, this tells us that those guys are not close at all to Islam. Now, I want to move to a very important point, which is making lots of Syrians running away and fleeing the country because of ISIS as well, not only because of Assad. And according to the survey, ISIS ranked number two as well in the survey we say at the beginning. Well, their policy is very clear, and that's their propaganda, international propaganda, terrorizing people. And they are very good at that because they brought apparently very professional filmmakers and very professional people to work on this field. And it's very clear that, like, if you are not with us, you are not part of us, you are not fighting with us, it means you are against us. And if you are against us, and that's like why I mentioned at the beginning there are takfiris. If you are against us, we have the right to kill you. So they are using the same kind of strategy or policy. Assad is terrorizing people by throwing barrel bombs wherever he doesn't like people or he thinks that there are some rebels against him. In order to push the population outside. ISIS is doing the same. They are trying to push the population outside as well. They just want people to stay there under their control with full loyalty to them. So this put ISIS, I think, in the same category as Assad, but of course Assad comes, I think, ranks higher because he has killed more people. From a statistic point of view. The second thing I'm going to share with you, or the next thing, is a story I had to go through because it happened to one of my very good friends who has recently arrived to Germany. So my friend is a surgeon, and unfortunately, he is from a town in eastern Aleppo, controlled by ISIS, and he had to go through 6 months of hell living there while ISIS was in full control. So he told me like very interesting details, being a surgeon and highly respected in the town and coming from a very like well-known family. They were very nice to him. They did not say anything bad to him. They did not come and terrorize him or anything, but still, the rules were there. There was a set of rules and instructions as a doctor and surgeon he has to follow. And they came to his clinic every single day. They did not come to tell him we are coming to check on you. They came to have a nice chat, drink a cup of tea, and see if he's doing well, or if everything is fine, or if he needs any help or any support. Of course, he could not do anything. He was stuck with his family there, and it was not an easy thing to flee. At some point, they offered to give him the management of a hospital they are planning to build in that town, and he said yes. Okay, I will manage the hospital for you. 2 weeks later, he told them that he has to take his mother to Damascus for an urgent surgery. And in a way, he told them, like, come on, I'm loyal to you. I will just, my mother needs treatment. I will treat my mother and come back. And that was the only way for him out. So he had to go against, he had to lie. He had to pretend. He had to go through lots of other horrible things. He had to adapt to their, like, life. Although he did not have anything to do with that, and he does not agree with that, and I'm quoting him now, he said, I'm ready, or I was ready to live in hell, but not under the control of those guys, simply because what they are doing is a complete brainwash to everybody who is living there. Now, some people have no other choice. They have no money, they have no power, they have no they are not doctors, they are not like engineers that can, in a way, work their way out, and they are stuck. And those people who are stuck there are trying hard, trying really very hard just to leave these areas and flee. What I'm trying to say here, you might see people, or you, I think you saw people at Keleti or in Budapest or in Europe or in Germany with like a headscarf. Or you might see people like with beards and so on. And they will tell you that we are Muslims. But this does not mean that those people are terrorists, or like those people are in Europe because they want to overrule the continent and start something completely different and revolutionary and question European values, Western values, and so on. Those people are basically run away. They run away for a better life. They run away to be able to practice whatever they believe in a healthy environment, not in an environment where you have to follow me or I will kill you. Or you have to do everything I tell you, follow all the rules, and the moment I see you doing something else, I might throw you from like the top of the building, or I might stone you to death, or I might cut your hand, or I might just literally behead you, and so on. And these things are things everybody is seeing like every day. The last thing I'd like to talk about is a personal concern. My family is still in Syria, and they are in the countryside of Aleppo. They are not in the east part, they are in the south. And lately I was in touch with one of my childhood friends, and he was telling me that he was going to one of the towns to do some business and trade. And like when he told me the name of the town, I was very surprised. He said, I'm going to Al-Bab. And Al-Bab is one of the strongest points in the eastern countryside of Aleppo, controlled by ISIS. I was like, how can you go there? Well, he said, you know what? I go there, they are quite respectful. They don't they don't do anything bad to me. I go do my business, I show respect, they show respect back, and things are fine. Like I'm making my living by trading there, because simply I cannot trade anywhere else. And that made me really, really think a lot, and that scared me a lot, that in a way, in this situation, in, like in this very chaotic situation where people are mainly trapped, and they cannot go to Aleppo, for example, because it's very dangerous in the eastern part, where Assad is bombing every day. And they cannot afford living in the western part of Aleppo, and there is already no space for people for more people to move to the western part of Aleppo, controlled by the regime, price-wise and population-wise. So some people are really trapped, and ISIS is working, I think, on the idea of gaining the trust of more people. And it is happening, because the areas controlled by ISIS are the areas least attacked by Assad and by Russia right now, and by everybody who is coming to Syria to fight against ISIS. So in a way, if you live under the control of ISIS, you have this illusion of being safe. And you have, again, the brainwash process that starts with children from age 5, training camps, till age 14. That starts with all the mosques which turn to be religious Islamic schools that are teaching extremist Islamic ideas. So the danger is really, really big, I think. And like I think it is increasing by the day. If they started with 5 years old kids, in 5 years, those kids will be fighting on the front lines. I mean, to me, we should not maybe now concentrate, as Hakan mentioned, on ISIS as like first, because after all, ISIS in Syria are foreigners. Mainly, they are led by foreigners, organized by foreigners, and operating mainly with foreigners. We should concentrate on the first and the main reason, the root reason, which is the Syrian regime.
And we should start doing that very quickly. Then the next step, of course, can be ISIS, but every day they are there, the danger is getting bigger. And thank you very much for listening.
مساء الخير جميعا وبحب اتشكركم لوجودكم للاستماع لجزء من الحقيقه اللي اجيتوا مشانها
He thanks you for coming here to listen to some of the truth that he actually came here to tell you.
من 2011 2013 مقيم بسوريا من 2013 2015 مقيم في المملكه الاردنيه الهاشميه.
He has a different accent. I thought he was saying 2017 I lived in Jordan. No, 2013. So from 2011 to 2013 he was in Syria, Man was in Syria, and from 2013 to 2014
Jordan.
He was in Jordan. To 2015. Yeah, again. 2011, 2013 in Syria, 13 to 15 in Jordan.
بداية كنا موجودين بدرعا بدأت الحراك سلمي بداية قبل كل أي شيء هي عبارة عن اعتقال الأطفال 14 طفل أعمارهم تتراوح 10 سنوات بالصف الرابع تم اعتقالهم بداية قبل أي شيء تم اعتقال الأطفال وبدأ حراك سلمي مطالب الأطفال
It all started in Daraa in southern Syria when with the peaceful protests and before that when 14 children in Daraa were arrested
المظاهرات بدأت أول شيء أول محافظة هي محافظة درعا بدأ الحراك السلمي والمظاهرات المطالبة بالأطفال.
The peaceful demonstrations started in Daraa after that, and it was before anywhere else in Syria.
كان التعامل مع المظاهرات عبارة عن إطلاق رصاص حي وقتل للمتظاهرين.
The regime response was merely firing at protests and killing them.
استمرت المظاهرات لمدة 6 أشهر محافظة درعا هي بتتحمل جزء من نوع من المعاناة اللي عانيناها احنا ابناء المحافظة 3 أشهر من التضييق والحصار والتعتيم الاعلامي وعدم خروجنا للمحافظات الثانية والحصار اللي صار على ابناء المحافظة ممنوع نغادر محافظتنا
This peaceful phase continued for 6 months and for the first 3 months Daraa took the brunt of it with the blockade not only the killings but also the sieges inside the province through checkpoints
اقامت سنه بعد غادرت محافظه درعا اقامت سنه في دمشق سنه كامله لكن الامور بدات تزداد اسوا واسوا والامور صفت تنحدر للاسوا من المسار تدريجي نحو السلميه باتجاه نحو الحرب والصورة المسلحة اللي بدأت تظهر على الحراك.
And then he was for 1 year in Damascus, and he saw how gradually it started to move into becoming violent, moving from peaceful.
غادرت دمشق ورديت رجعت على مدينتي على مدينة درعا واستمريت فيها لل 2013. الوضع كان بالمدينة نوع غياب عن ما في امان ما في قصف بس لكن كان في عباره عن نوع من الخوف والذعر اعتقالات الوضع كان شبه من السجن سجن مغلق خوف وكانت المدينه محاصره من قطع عسكريه كانت المدينه تقصف المدن الثانيه فاحنا نعاني صعوبات بانه ما كنا ننام بالخمسة او ستة الصبح من جراء القصف اللي كان يترافق على المدن الثانية.
So there was a point in Damascus where it was difficult to live. No, Damascus, that's why he moved from Damascus into Daraa. So, and in Daraa, when he stayed there about a year, he saw how it was controlled by the regime. There was no shelling where he was. But they saw how the bombs would fly over their heads into the other towns. Also, there were arrests, especially of males.
بعدين صفينا عرضة للخطر. صفينا أنا وأخي مطلوبين للخدمة الإلزامية.
And then they became in threat of being detained because he and his brother would have to do their military service.
كل يوم مداهمات.
Every day there were searches and arrests.
قررنا المغادرة الأردن بطريق محفوف بالمخاطر بمحفوف بطرق محفوفة تابعة لسيطرة النظام وطرق تابعة لسيطرة المعارضة وكان طريق شبه خطر يعني.
So they decided to go to Jordan and to get there they had to go through areas controlled by the regime and the rebels fluctuating here and there until they got to Jordan.
مو كل الحدود الأردنية بتستقبل اللاجئين بعض المدن الحدودية اللي هي بتستقبل اللاجئين على الحدود مو أي طريق أو أي مكان حصرا ثلاث مدن موجودة على الحدود الأردنية السورية هي بتستقبل اللاجئين السوريين.
And you couldn't go get into Jordan through any border point you wanted. There were only three border towns through which you could get into Jordan.
من عام 2013-2015 الفترة اللي مرت بالأردن هي فترة صعبة جدا للغاية. الوثيقة معي وثيقة حاليا هي وثيقة تسجيل بالأمم المتحدة. هاي الوثيقة الوثيقة ها هي وثيقة تسجيل الأمم المتحدة بأحد البنود تبعها بتقول الوثيقة هذه الوثيقة لا تحول حاملها الحصول على تصريح عمل أو إقامة في الأردن.
So he got this document from UNHCR in Jordan and it reads this certificate does not entitle the holder to a residency or a work permit in Jordan.
هاي طبعا للاجئين طبعا الاغلبيه من اللاجئين 90% داخلين هم لاجئين بيحملوا هاي الهويه فبالتالي 90 من اغلب اللاجئين الموجودين بالاردن ما بيمكنوا لا يمكنهم العمل الا بتصريح حصرا وتصريح ما في تصاريح للعمل
اغلبهم كمان دون هاي. So 90% of refugees, Syrian refugees in Jordan had this document, so they could not get that. So not all actually applied to be a refugee or had to be registered as a refugee. Others entered the country not as a refugee.
أخي تم إمساكه وهو عم يعمل بالعمل وتم ترحيله على سوريا إعادته على سوريا.
So they had to work illegally in the black job market. His brother was once detained, caught red-handed as he was working, and he was given an eviction into Syria.
Yes. ظلت الامور شبه مغلقه لطالب جامعي مثل انا كطالب جامعي ما في لا في فرص عمل ولا شيء والاحوال الاجتماعيه سيئه كل اسره او اسرتين او ثلاث اسر تضطر تاخذ بيت او منزل واحد منزل لتقدر تامن معيشها او نفقاتها.
So things were getting harder even for him as a university student and families had to live together so every about two to three families would rent a house together.
برنامج الأغذية العالمية كان يقدم 24 دينار بال 2014 نهاية 2014 انخفضت المساعدات ل 10 دنانير بعدين كان حق الطبابة موجود للجميع تم إلغاء حق الطبابة للاجئين الخارجين بالخارج المخيمات.
So he says the World Food Program, I'm not sure if it is the one, maybe UNHCR, but anyway, used to give them coupons of 24 Jordanian dinars a month. That's slightly more than that in US dollars, about 30 US dollars or something. But at the end of 2014, this 24 Jordanian dinars was reduced to 12. Yeah. And medication, sorry, yes. And medical treatment that was a right to refugees there was taken away from them.
اغلب اللاجئين الموجودين بالاردن هم عم بيعانوا شبه نوع من عدم قله الموارد، عدم العمل، الاوضاع الانسانيه سيئه، عباره عن سجن كامل، واغلب الموجودين باللاجئين ما بيحملوا جوازات سفر ليغادروا المملكه، بيظلوا موجودين بالمملكه، وكانت السفاره السوريه مغلقه بوجه السوريين، ممنوع تجديد الجوازات، ممنوع اصدار جوازات.
So most Syrians in Jordan live in very difficult situations and they're not allowed to work or they work illegally and they don't even have the proper documents like passports because the Syrian embassy in Amman was closed.
استطعت انه اجدد جوازي بتمديد مزور واغادر المملكه بس لكن اغلب اللاجئين اللي ما كانوا يقدروا يمددوا جوازات كانوا يرجعوا بطريق يرجعوا على سوريا ومن سوريا يرجعوا يكملوا على الحدود التركيه اذا بترجع على الخريطه
هي يعني لما قررت انه
تمام بس أرجع الخريطه والطريق
So Nain decided in 2015 to leave the country. He couldn't extend his passport legally through the embassy, so he had to rely on fake extensions. So his passport is original, but they give you a sticker, and this sticker was a faked one. Of course, he didn't know that because someone told him, I'll do it for you through the embassy in Bahrain, the Syrian embassy there. And it was just someone who was actually just getting fake extensions instead. Those who can't do that, and it cost you $400. Yes, an extension, $400, which is more than that in dollars. Those who couldn't extend, they had to take a different route into Europe, those who couldn't get proper identification papers.
أصدقائي أو العوائل السورية اللي ما معهم جوازات سفر بدهم يرجعوا على الطريق البري على النحو
So if you don't have a passport, his friends, among his friends were some, they had to take the land route this way. This used to be $4 in the past before the war, and it used to take 6 hours, and now it's $100. They go into Daraa back. Then they go through Damascus countryside and then through the Syrian desert. Then through ISIS controlled areas. Regime areas again. The opposition held areas, and then into Turkey. 24 hours instead of the 6 pre-war hours.
طبعا طريق التهريب تتجه مباشرة لأزمير على السواحل التركية لتنطلق.
These smuggling routes go directly to Izmir in Turkey,
طبعا الطريق محفوف بالمخاطر مو البلم هو الدرجة الأولى بالمخاطرة، البلم هو عبارة عن نوع يعني بسيط من المخاطرة، السيارات أحيانا اللي بتقل اللاجئين لمكان النقطة اللي بدهم ينطلقوا فيها بيكون الطريق عبارة عن خطر مثل الحالة اللي صارت فينا كانت رح تقلب السيارة يعني تتدهور السيارة على الطريق جراء مطاردة الشرطة للسيارة والسائق التركي رفض التوقف.
To be transported into the points where the dinghy boats leave, they had to get into buses that don't want to be caught by the police, so they speed up. And that was a greater perceived threat and fear. And actually there are many accidents that where buses just topple because of speeding up, running away from the police, where they are transporting Syrians into the points at the coast. Yeah.
السيارة دائما بتكون هي أخطر من البلم. السيارات اللي كنا ركبنا فيها هي عبارة عن رحلة محفوفة بالمخاطر ونوع من الرعب الداخلي رعب مو طبيعي السيارة. يعني البلم هو درجة الخطورة فيه أقل بالنسبة للسيارة.
So being in the car was a greater danger than taking the dinghy. The fear you feel when you are in the car as it's speeding is so great.
يعني احد المنعطفات السائق السائق بيجيب المنعطف اللي بينحدر فيه ل 80 و 100 درجه 100 درجه بالقياده هي منعطف يعني مايكل شوماخر ما بيجيب هيك يعني ملفاته
Sometimes even Michael Schumacher couldn't do what these do which is for example turning at 180 degrees
الطريق بس تصل لليون الطريق البحري في حالات غرق بالتم بالبلم هي حالات عدم توازن البلم والخوف والرعب اللي بصير جراء الفوضى والرعب اللي بتدب بالبلم الحالات الغرق هي نتيجة الرعب نتيجة عدم التوازن أو الطقس والموج ودخولهم بالمياه الإقليمية بصير الوضع مختلف بيزداد نسبة الرعب بيهتز البلم أكثر وأكثر والرعب بيزداد عند اللاجئين
Man is talking from his experience as someone who took one of these dinghy boats, and is saying that the danger comes from the threat of the boat capsizing, because some of the reasons are the weather, of course, but also, and the boat not being good, but also the panic of the people as they move from one side to side and the balance is tipped.
اتجهنا لمقدونيا والصربيا الطريق قبل ما يكون مفتوح والسلطات المقدونية والسلطات الصربية بتساعد للوصول هاي طبعا بعد ما وصلنا اليونان المقدونيا والصربيا كان طريق مغلق فإجباري كنا نلجأ لمهرب وسيارات وطرق والحكي كان بشهر ثلاثة فالجو والطقس بارد جدا جدا واستمرنا بالطريق
And that was March when he got in Greece, and then to get Macedonia and Serbia had closed their borders. They're not as open as they are today, so they had to be smuggled through to Hungary.
كمان بس نرجع لموضوع
نرجع
لموضوع نرجع لموضوع السيارة 11 شخص تم وضعنا بسيارة سازايو قديمة هي طاقتها القصوى خمس أشخاص حطينا 11 شخص فيها بمقدونيا للحدود الصربية
So from Macedonia to the Serbian borders they had to get into an old Daio car that had the capacity of only 5 people but they were 11 in that car and it was speeding to Serbia
كمان الوضع مرعب كمان السيارة مرعبة مغلقة النوافذ ما في أي طرق ما بتعرفون
All the windows were closed in that vehicle
ثمن السيارة كله ما بتروح 300 دولار
This is probably a $300 car
بترد كمان بترد عبرنا صربيا دخلنا بصربيا ردينا كمان بالسيارة للوصول لمقر الحافلات توصلنا كمان لصربيا كمان السيارة كمان سرعة جنونية والساق كمان عم يمشي ب كمان مايكل شوماخر سرعة قيادية وجنونية يعني كمان نوع من الرعب داخلي
The same thing in Serbia also the drivers driving really fast
بعد وصلنا لمقدونيا شبه كان الطريق عبور صربيا ومقدونيا كان مغلق او مجبر نقطع بالغابات اخطر طريق صراحه وشعرت بالرعب مزبوط فيه واللي شعرت فيه بخوف خوف مزبوط هو الغابات الصربيه الهنغاريه
So going to Hungary from Serbia they had to go through the forests and that was اكثر شيء خفت من
الغابات الصربيه الهنغاريه
yeah, scary and dangerous thing to do.
شيء مرعب حقيقي حيوانات برية خنازير
wild animals wild
درجات حرارة منخفضة برد
very cold it was
سلمت حالي لهنغاريا وطلبت اللجوء بهنغاريا واستمرت بهنغاريا وحالي أنا موجود هون
he decided to go and what's the proper word here submit himself to the police and to the Hungarian authorities and he decided to seek asylum here and he's fine with this choice now he's staying in Hungary
انا موجود هون لاني بدي احافظ على انسانيتي يعني انا موجود هون لمشان اكمل بانسانيتي اللي انا موجود فيها ما بدي اتخلى عن الانسانيه وبدي ترجع الانسانيه وكبرت فيها
as a refugee he wants to be a refugee in Hungary in order to keep his humanity, which he doesn't want to give up.
الإنسان هي الإنسان شيء رائع حقيقة الإنسان والأخلاق والحياة اللي متعلمها عن أنفسنا والإخلاق اللي الإنسان بكامل إنسانيته هي بتحافظ عليها الموجودين اللي كنا بسوريا ما كنا نشعر بإنسانية كنا نتعامل بنوع من كامل غياب كامل عن الإنسانية وال
Keeping his ethics is gives him wonderful feelings. In Syria, he could not get that feeling. There was a total absence of humanity there.
أنا بتمنى أظل هون وتنفتح لي فرصة جديدة وأكمل دراستي وأرد أرجع للجامعة وهو مكاني الطبيعي إني أرجع لمكاني وهي الدراسة والجامعة.
He would like to stay here and take his proper position, which is university. He'd like to continue his studies here. In Hungary. Maybe
شكراً
see you.
شكراً لكم.
Thank you.
Hello everyone. I see some bored faces. I will be very, very quick. It's kind of difficult to talk after this. It's an emotional story, I wasn't very far from that a while ago, but this is kind of fresh. It refreshed my feelings, so I have to collect myself. It's also difficult because I'm going to more a rather theoretical general, I will give a general theoretical talk to, but I believe this is quite important to understand the situation and think about a solution. So the first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to ask you a question, and I would like you to raise your hands. Who believes or who supports the idea that what's going on in Syria today is a civil war? Please raise your hands. Okay. And who says the opposite? It's not a civil war. Okay, well, it's surprising. The majority says has no answer, but that's also that's also not yes. Well, this is the reality. We don't really know what's going on. So my assessment is that I would argue that it's not really a civil war. Why? My argument is that on the territory of Syria, there are multiple different wars fought by different actors. So those different actors can be fighting within one type of war, that is true. But in Syria, this is not the case. Just to clarify, I will give you examples. There are many different wars. I'm going to give you the three most obvious examples. For example, when we take ISIS and the Kurdish forces, this is not a civil war, right? Because those two are not state actors. So this is intercommunal or non-state war. So this is one type of war. And then if we take the regime and the opposition, I will simplify by just saying opposition, then we realize that this is close to civil war, but it's not really a civil war, and I will tell in a minute why. And then we have another war which is going on in the same territories, which is the international coalition led by the United States against Al-Qaeda affiliated groups and ISIS. So at this point we need to realize that there are different wars fought. Of course, all these wars are fought in one context. We cannot separate, we cannot put a clear dichotomy between this all. However, I believe those are different wars. So here is the problem. If we want to solve the Syrian conflict, which war do we focus on? So my argument is that there is a core main conflict, main war in Syria, which is composed by two actors. One is the regime, and the other is the opposition. So what I'm arguing here is that there are different conflicts, but the main source, the core conflict, is the incompatibility between the government and the opposition groups. And I call this internationalized civil war. Civil war scholars and conflict scholars might disagree with me, just keep that in mind, but I would still argue that this is an internationalized civil war. So why I'm telling this, because we first need to understand which war we are exactly going to solve and from where we're going to start and what are we going to focus. It seems that today the international community mostly, I wouldn't say the Syrians, but the key international actors are obsessed with ISIS. You have the feeling that the biggest war happened in Syria, the biggest battle happened in Syria was in Kobani between ISIS and the Kurds. And if you compare it to other areas, it's just a minor battle. Why? Because we're focusing on ISIS. One major problem why we're focusing on the ISIS and not the core main war in Syria is because the world, and I'm going to use a very IR term here, the hegemony, so the leading power in the world, United States, does not have a strategy to solve the key conflict in Syria between the regime and the opposition. On the contrary, it has a deterrence strategy against ISIS. So, before the Syrian conflict, when the international big actors such as the United States do not have strategies on solving the conflict, this goes on and on and on. So the other face is Russia. Is Russia focusing on this main war or the core war? Yes, it is. But what is the problem? The problem is that it is not supporting any logical solution, but it's trying to keep its ally alive. And this comes, the Russian intervention comes in this context. So the first step that I tried to do, I don't know if I succeeded, trying to clarify that we have to focus on the main war, which is the regime versus the opposition. So how do we solve this conflict? On the one hand, we always say, I mean, me included, that Syria is a very complicated case, and we haven't seen anything like this in history, and all this, mainly in newspapers you see this. But actually, no, classical conflict resolution studies do help us, at least to think. So what I'm going to do, I will try to draw a framework, a very simple framework. So we agreed, right, that this is the main conflict. So what do? We mediate as an international community or world leading powers and regional actors try to mediate. What we have tried so far? We tried facilitation, which basically means that bring the regime representative, bring some of the opposition representatives, and let them talk. Geneva 1, Geneva 2, Moscow 1 didn't really give anything. The second type is like more of a mediation, which means that you come with a text and try to convince the sides to come up with a solution. And Dimistura has been trying to do this in Aleppo, which hasn't also worked. What didn't we try? I think we didn't try the one which I believe leads to the solution, which is imposing a solution on the Syrian on the fighters. And the fighting sides in Syria. What does imposing mean? So this is the final thing I want to share with you. Imagine three levels: international level, regional level, and the local level. So let's try to map the key actors. On the international level, specifically in the Syrian case, we have United States and Russia. So what I'm suggesting is that these two countries, Washington and Moscow, they have to come together and draft a solution on Syria. So the solution in Syria should come from the top. So this means that the interest of Russia and United States will be considered greatly. But we cannot impose anything on the Syrian fighting sides, namely the regime and the opposition, if we do not cooperate with the regional actors. And surprisingly, the regional actors are also quite clear who they are. On the one side, it's Iran, and the other side is Turkey and Saudi Arabia. So I believe these three actors should take part, and the major powers, Russia and United States, also have to practice some pressure on these actors to be more serious, more willing, more engaged, not with ISIS, not with other conflicts, but the key problem in Syria, regime versus the opposition. And then the third level, the local level, comes the regime, of course, more specifically the warlords and the criminals, and on the other side, the main opposition groups, which are also, I believe, mainly warlords. The ugly reality is that you have to bring these warlords together to you know, stop killing people. I have to say that, unfortunately, the Syrian actors do not have too much of say in this method that I'm suggesting. This is, of course, unfortunate, and you know, as someone coming from there, I'm saying this with a broken heart, but they are so dependent. The regime is increasingly dependent on Russia now and Iran, and the opposition is very much dependent on the regional allies and also the international support. So in any solution, they won't have that much of a say. So I'm going to conclude with two recommendations. One, focusing on the main problem and hoping that the international powers will have some kind of a strategy on solving the Syrian conflict. Unfortunately, we still have to wait for this until the new president comes in Washington, D.C. And the second recommendation is that the major powers should impose the solution, should come up with a solution and impose on the Syrian fighting sides if we want to stop the conflict soon. If not, I think the sides are not in a position to sign any agreement by their own. Sorry for this bad notes. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's open the floor to any questions. Be grateful if you could identify yourself. There are some microphones, so if you put up your hands and we'll get a microphone to you. Gentleman here.
Thank you. Just looking at the map, is it possible to cut up this country to three areas and then put function simply or independently of the others?
If you mean for a long-term solution, it depends which areas these are. The Kurdish areas, for example, might probably get some autonomy. They already have it, and it might be a good solution for that to continue. But if you're talking about the rest of Syria, there's no evidence that this will be a good solution. If you mean during the conflict now, this is the reality, that these areas are separate, they're governed separately, differently. And I think, a part of my belief is that we have to engage with sensitivity to each area and each group that's controlling these areas, not just the groups like the armed groups, but also the populations. So we need to engage very sensibly, really.
Actually, if we look at this map, it's not possible to divide it into three, as it is shown there. I mean, who are the three? The three parts. Who are the leaders of the three parts you're trying to, like, we are trying to divide the map amongst? Are we, like, if you look at the map, there is like the biggest area is controlled by ISIS, and none of us want ISIS to be part of the division or to be an existing part of in the Syrian map. If we ignore like ISIS now, we already have three very complicated areas, as you see. Maybe not for the Kurdish part, because in a way, as Hakan mentioned, it's an autonomy now. But if you look at the regime and the opposition or the rebels, it is very interrelated and it's very complicated as it is to be divided. If we add now ISIS to the equation. It is not possible, I think, at all.
Any questions?
I'm Barabás Balázs from District 24 main in TV station, and I have several questions, if you don't mind. One is saying that as the difference and the conflict between the Sunnis and the Shiites, which is hard to understand in Europe. I mean, how do you differentiate between yourselves when a Shiite goes to beat a Sunni? How do you differentiate between, how do you recognize a Sunni and a Shia? Probably it's very common, but it's not clear to me. The second question is to the young man who was speaking in Arabic. I didn't retain his name, unfortunately.
His name is Man.
Man, okay, good. So my question to him is, and to all of you, what is Hungary perceived in Syria? Is it known, Hungary and Romania, because I'm correspondent for Romanian TV station and I'm interested in this. Is there an image in Syria before you left Syria? Was there an image about Hungary that you want to go there, or to Germany or Austria or whatever other country? And the third question is, what was your impression on Hungary after you arrived here? Was it what you hoped to see, or was it something different? How are the government's actions perceived by you? Do you see the government as hostile or positive towards refugees? And plus one question. How were you received by the Muslim population here? Were you contacted by them, or were they welcoming, or they didn't care about you at all? Thank you.
Okay, so start with question one.
Maybe I will start with the first. Thanks for raising this question, and I really love answering this question. because it, really this is a misconception. Shias killing Sunnis. Sunnis kill, I mean, my colleagues may have different opinions, but I would argue that the conflict in Syria is first and foremost a political conflict. It's not a religious conflict. There is not just Shias taking arms and going and killing other Sunnis just because they are Sunnis. What is happening is that you have to divide at least to two levels. There is the state or political level where leaders, political leaders, probably with some religious coloring, political leaders, they mobilize people on religious basis. So what is happening is that there is a religious, there is a mobilization from religious ranks. But saying that one side, for example, the rebels who are mainly Sunni, and the government fighters who are dominated by Alawites, describing this as Sunnis against Alawites, which is like one branch of Shiism, describing this as a Sunni against Alawite, I think this is a misconception. Probably on the very, very ground level, people are motivated with some religious motives. However, on a general context, not a religious group is fighting another religious group.
Not necessarily Syria, let's talk about Iraq.
Yes,
probably. Right.
Yeah. Well, and very shortly, even in Iraq, it is the same. Why did ISIS come up? Not because they are fighting the Shias, because the government was depriving this Sunni population from basic needs. Okay, but let's not go to Iraq.
Yes, please.
Very briefly. So, yeah, again, it's not like by the looks or anything. It's through your connections, family connections, neighborhood connections, actually village connections. So in Syria, for example, Alawites dwell in the mountainous areas, mostly smaller towns and villages. And you give a job to your, it's not just because he's from your town, but because this is a part of the regime policy over, like since 1963. This is a way to consolidate power within the family. How can you also tell? The accent. Every Syrian knows that. You know the word Quran, for example? Yeah? This Qu, yeah? It's Quran. This Qu is pronounced as Qu by Alawites and as U by most others. It's not, doesn't hold true everywhere, but it's a very well-known fact that if you enter an ex-government directorate and you have some business to do, just throw some ko-ko-ko and your job is done quickly.
Yeah, it's a fact. Actually, I just wanted to add something to the first question, which is a very interesting point. You raised in your question. You are a journalist from Hungary and Romania, right? And you said, how can you differentiate between sects in Syria because I don't know? To me, that's quite interesting because lots of people in the West started saying it's a religious war, it's a sectarian war, not knowing anything about the sects in Islam or the different sects in Syria and how these sects in Islam and other religions were living together for a very long time without any war. So that's a very interesting point for me to receive from you.
It was just a private curiosity.
Yeah, I understand, but I have heard this a lot. Like, I don't know about the sects, I don't know about like this and that. I think we can move to the second question for Man.
So the second question was, سؤال ثاني كان. إنه شلون شفت استقبال الهنغاريين لك في هنغاريا؟ هذا الجزء أول السؤال والجزء الثاني
كان
في عندك انطباعات معينة عن هنغاريا قبل ما تجي لهون وبعدين كان في شق ثاني شلون استقبلوك إذا في عرب أو مسلمين هون التقيت بأي حدا التقيت منهم أي معاملة أو شيء أو شو انطباعك؟
بداية كنا بصربيا وكانت كل الطرق ما في هنغاريا خارج كل الاحتمالات تماما يعني النمسا أستريا جرمني فرنسا any country just هنغاريا no
So when they were in Austria, Hungary was out of the question. Austria, Germany, you heard the rest.
أغلب الأشخاص اللي كانوا يحكوا عن هنغاريا إنه هنغاريا ما فيها مساعدات، ما فيها أي شيء، دولة فقيرة، معدومة الموارد، ما بتقدم أي شيء للاجئين، ما فيها يعني بزنس، أموال قليلة، مساعدات قليلة، ما في فرص اندماج.
So all people knew that Hungary was not as privileged economically as other countries. Not enough maybe support for refugees, not enough integration effort for them.
بعد ما تم إلقاء القبض بالغابة علينا تم اقتيادنا للمركز تم تسجين اللاجئين بتبصينا بشكل أو بآخر بنوع من اختياري يعني بدك تضل تستمر عنا بهنغاري بتبصم في هنغاريت أو ترجع come back سيربيا.
Yeah, so when he was caught in the forest as he was entering Hungary, he was given choice whether you want to give your fingerprints here or go back to Serbia. That's March
2015.
So there was talk among the Syrians back then that, oh, don't worry, the Hungarian fingerprint doesn't matter that much if you want to move on to France or Germany.
خلال وجودنا بالكامب بدأنا نتعرف على أشخاص موجودين بالكامب بهنغاريا بالبيتش كتقريبا وفي أشخاص صاروا يخبرونا إنه بتقدم لك مساعدات مالية بتقدم لك فرصة سكن بتقدم لك فرصة بالاندماج فرصة بالأكثر من فرصة بتجيك وصراحة بالنسبة لي كشخص أنا بالنسبة عن تجربتي أنا أغلب الأشخاص كانوا يغادروا هنغاريا لسبب إنه العامل المادي البزنس طبعا أنا شخصيا ما بهتم بالأمور المادية لأن المادة
So, and when he went to Bichke camp, he met others there who have applied for asylum, and they started to tell him that it's going to be okay. You are going to get some, even some aid, support after your asylum asylum is given to you. But I mean, other people don't stay because they don't see it functioning for any entrepreneurial perspective for the future to have a business. You are less likely to flourish here. So financially, economically, it's an important thing to consider for the future.
خلال تواجدي بالكامب الجالية العربية والإسلامية قدمت كثير مساعدات وقدمت كثير من المساعدات الخيرية وجدت وساعدتني كثير الجالية العربية والإسلامية قدمت لنا كثير مساعدات.
So the Arab and Islamic communities when he was in the camp offered them a lot of help. They used to come there, give aid.
بالفترة اللي فترة أحداث الكلتي إجت مساعدات ضخمة للاجئين ولبيتشكا من كافة الدول من النمسا الدول التشيك كافة الناشطين أغلب ناشطين العالم تضامنوا وقدموا مساعدات ضخمة للكامب
يعني
الأجانب
العرب
الأجانب
Yeah, but when they were at Bichke, there was a lot of help from the people in Austria, Germany. And then I asked him to clarify whether he meant Arabs there, and he said no, both. And so not just Arabs, but there were also Arabs and Muslims at Keleti helping, but everyone else as well.
هلا العنصرية أنت يمكن السؤال المطروح لأنه إنه هل شاهدت نوع من العنصرية أو نوع من الخوف أو الكره من الناس الموجودين لكم بعض الحالات قليلة لا ممكن لا يمكن القياس عليها دائما بس لكن إنه بالفترة الأحداث الكلتي لاحظنا إنه في شعارات بوسترات بالطرق بالعامة إنه غير مرحبة صارت باللاجئين وكأنه يمكن بدأت يعني إنه الأحداث الكلتي شوي أثرت على المناخ بشكل عام
So at the beginning, they did not sense any kind of racism or lack of welcoming or good reception. But with Kennedy, around the times when things got complicated there, he noticed things worsened, particularly with the billboard in the streets that had anti-refugee migrant rhetoric.
الحياة أحد الأسئلة اللي تم طرحها علينا إنه ليش ظليت أنت هون بهنغاريا؟ فكان سؤالي جوابي واضح إنه الحياة الاجتماعية هون بهنغاريا شبيهة بالحياة الاجتماعية السورية موجودة بسوريا وطبيعة الشعب يعني تقريبا نفس طبيعة الشعب السوري يعني نفس طبيعة الشعب السوري.
So when asked by many why did you choose to stay in Hungary, the reason he says is that life here is quite similar to life in Syria, and the nature of people here is also quite similar.
And I think this could be taken politically, I guess.
I don't know.
Yeah, Syria number two.
This is Syria number two to him.
Thank you so much.
عم بقول لك انه هو ما ممكن يكون اسعد من هيك كثير سعيد هو يسمع منك الحكي
Thank you so much.
I have a couple of questions to Man. One question, how much money did you spend in total to get here? And how about your family? And where do you see your future? Like either here or back in Syria?
الأفراد أسرتي مكونة من خمس أشخاص موجودين بأربع دول.
His family is five people and they are in four different countries.
والدي والدتي موجودين بسوريا.
His parents are in Syria.
أخي بفرنسا وأختي بالأردن.
His brother is in France and his sister is in Jordan. تكلفة؟
تكلفة بتكلف بين 2500 دولار.
لا قديش كلفتك أنت شخصياً رحلتك من الأردن لهنغاريا؟ It cost him around $2,500 like the whole trip from Jordan to Budapest.
بعض الطرق ما استعنا فيها بالمهربين يعني ما استعنا بطرق دخلنا بمشي يعني دفعنا تعب كان فقط.
And of course he managed to get by sometimes without the help of smugglers. He was walking and
الطريق حاليا ارخص من هيك تكلفته منخفضه لانه مقدونيا وصربيا فتحوا الطرق يعني بصفى الطريق بس من تركيا لليونان.
So the cost now is a bit lower because the border is open or like there is it's easier to move through borders. So the only cost is between Turkey to Greece. أو شو بالنسبة لتركيا للمستقبل؟
هلا حاليا هو موجود هون لاخر السنه صراحه، انا حاليا الحكومه الهنغاريه من حكم حمايه خمس سنوات. خلال الشهرين هذول الاول السنه اذا ما جتني فرصه اني اكمل تعليمي، تعليم ماني عم بدور على شغل، هي الدراسه. انا راح اغادر لدوله ثانيه، راح اروح لعند اخي على فرنسا.
So he got 5-year protection from the Hungarian government.
Subsidiary protection.
Okay, and he's going to wait for 1 year, and his main goal is to continue his studies. So if he manages to get an opportunity to study at the university, he will stay. Otherwise, he's thinking about moving somewhere else.
Of course.
Yeah. As he said.
لا مو هو الموضوع انه الشعب الموجود الاطفال السوريين البنى التحتيه الوطن بحاجه ترجع الابناء تبنيهم ما راح حدا يجي يبني اخر شيء.
Syria needs its own people. So he is going to come back for sure.
يعني معنا شهادات جامعية احنا اقل ما يمكن نبدا بالحاضنة هي التربية المدارس الاطفال بس تبدا الاطفال تروح على المدارس.
And he is a person with education, university education, and he believes that education is very important back in Syria once life comes back to normal soon.
ممكن hope. اقل ما يمكن نقوم بتدريس الاطفال يعني بس الاطفال ترجع نقوم احنا بتدريس الاطفال.
The least he can do is teaching children. Back in Syria.
I know from the amount of time that Hakam and Armin devote to discussing the various merits of falafel and hummus in parts of Aleppo that they do intend to go back there at some stage. Let's just take one last question. There's someone right at the back. Gentleman right at the back.
Hi, my question is addressed to the last speaker. If I understood you correctly, you made two main points. One is that there is a core conflict, which is between the regime and the opposition, and the other is that kind of everyone involved in the conflict has to be included, so major powers and regional powers and so on. My question is, how do you address the opposition? Who is the opposition and how can they be represented? Are we talking about armed groups? Are we talking about political currents? So I see a major difficulty in that, especially looking back at the Geneva peace process and also the beginning of the escalation, where from my point of view, one of the major problems was that major or Western powers supported mostly an exile opposition, right?
Unlike the other question, I don't like to answer this one because it's difficult, but I will try. This is a key issue. So my first point is that before arriving to this stage, as I mentioned in my presentation, we first have to focus on this conflict and not other conflicts. We have to prioritize this conflict. So the second point, how do we gather the opposition? It's quite obvious that the opposition is scattered, of course. One thing you can do is to relatively unify source of funding. If you read through the structuration and the restructuration of the Free Syrian Army, you will see how Saudi money brings some groups to the top, and then the Qatari money brings other ones to the top. And this is one way. Second, Turkish border and Jordanian border, these two borders are very important for military and economic perspective. Once you have control on these borders, you can pressure groups. So there is an additional pressuring card on these groups. And the third thing that I believe, this is in theory, I don't know, it is the willingness of the regional and the international actors. There is lots of talk in the media that, for example, we're supporting the opposition. Yes, there is a support from the United States and the coalition and the other groups. But to what extent, what is the aim of this support? When we're supporting to this extent, it means that the opposition is not going to win against Assad or against ISIS. So you're kind of keeping the situation, which is very, very harmful. So I believe that the international actors, in cooperation with the regional actors, can mobilize the majority of the key rebel groups inside Syria and put them on the table. But this needs an international and regional political will, which is, I mean, I don't want to give false hopes. This is very far-reaching. It's very difficult. But it is not impossible.
So, first of all, for the solution that you suggest, I think there was no will until like 6 months ago that refugees came here and the Europe and US followed the tweets that, oh my God, there are refugees here, so we have to do something about Syria. And now they're like considering that, but when Russia attacked like ISIS and rebels in Syria, I think the game is changed now. I mean, because Russia, as one of the international actors, is like on the ground in Syria, the others, and Iran is kind of on the ground, but the others are not. So I don't think that they can, I don't know, come up with a solution in this situation that come together and say that, okay, we're gonna do this, and solve the whole problem. So I think it's a bit like shaky.
Very good point. However, I will actually argue the opposite. I mean, Russian intervention in Syria, any intervention in Syria which supports to the continuation of the armed activities without any political goal at the end is harmful for Syria. This is at least, I mean, not in theory, but in reality as well. However, Russian intervention, which is early to judge, I mean, they might, people are saying they will take troops there or not, we don't know yet. But the Russian intervention can actually turn positive. Why? Because with previously the Syrian government or the Syrian government was dependent on Russia mainly politically and diplomatically. They were supplying weapons. This is not a secret. But they didn't have airplanes on the ground. But today the government is even more dependent. So tomorrow, if Putin will stay, but Obama's successor, if they agree that Assad is going to go,
or is going to stay transitional period. There is Russia will be able to impose this on its Assad, because you simply you take the phone and say, you know, if you don't do that, I'm pulling out my airplanes, and in 2 days the rebels are in Damascus. So, but it can also turn opposite. If Russian strategists are thinking that they are going to support Assad to the extent that it is going to, you know, take the upper hand, the military upper hand, without any political goal at the end, then this turn will, you know, your the scenario that you said that would be well. But I always want to keep the positive one as well.
I fully agree with Arminak. And I would like to reiterate what I believe is the solution, is engaging responsibly. How, what does that mean? As the hegemony power in the world, like the US, for example, and other Western countries, you need to talk to the Russians, you need to talk to the Iranians, you need to talk to the regime, but you also must do your best to exert what is your right, or what is actually your responsibility as the international community, to protect civilians and support, again, with attention to sensitivities on the ground, like the people that can be relied on and the people who can't. You always have to kind of calibrate that. So now calibrate how much you need to protect people on the ground. Don't be engaged, of course, in a direct war with Russia. That's very irresponsible. But it is very responsible to give better weapons, anti-aircraft missiles, to the rebels on the ground. That's my opinion.
Okay, I think we're going to have to wrap it up there. It's past 7:30. I'd like to give personal thanks to Ilona Yez, who does wonderful work for us in organizing events like this. Unfortunately, moving on from our center, and of course to thank the panel for a very interesting presentation of the Syrian views here. Please join us for a drink now.